A lug nut and a bolt are both parts. A Ford F-150 and a Ford Explorer both have lug nuts and bolts. However, that doesn't mean the cars share a common ancestor. They are both created. Ergo, life was created by a designer. If this sounds like a good analogy, then it's fair to say you don't understand biology. Here's why. Do cars grow? Do they reproduce? Do they mutate? Do they contain cells or genetic material? Are they naturally selected? The answer to all these questions is a resounding no. So why are cars compared to life? In 1802, a theologian named William Paley published a book titled Natural Theology, wherein he argued that life was like a watch. A watch has a watchmaker, thus life has a life maker, which he said was God. Of course, most of us today recognize that the considerable differences between watches and life render the analogy untenable, but apparently some have been left behind. Man-made objects and living organisms have very few parts in common save for the subjective claim of complexity, and as such cannot be logically considered analogous to each other. Baby Ford F-150s don't come out of mother Ford F-150s, and airplanes don't evolve from skateboards. Man-made objects don't show common ancestry because there were never any common ancestors, period. So what is a common ancestor? The common ancestor between you and your brother is your mother. The common ancestor between you and your cousin is your shared grandmother. The same principle applies to all humans and all life. You share a common ancestor with chimps, gorillas, orangutans, monkeys, rodents, kangaroos, echidnas, toucans, snakes, frogs, lungfish, coelacanths, goldfish, sharks, and all other life. A Ford F-150 shares no common ancestors with anything because nothing ever gave birth to a Ford F-150. So how do we know that all organisms share a common ancestor? We can look at it from at least three different perspectives: morphology, genetics, and the fossil record. This list isn't exhaustive, but it gives us a good starting point. First, let us turn to morphology, which is defined as the branch of biology that deals with the form of living organisms and with relationships between their structures. All organisms share DNA, and even things that aren't quite living, viruses, have DNA. Creationists would say the ubiquity of DNA is due to a common designer, but what is their evidence? There is none. There are mountains of papers written by creationists that attempt to show flaws in the evolutionary theory, but there are no peer-reviewed studies. And what mechanism can be proposed for a supernatural entity to design organisms or anything at all? There is none. And why did the designer give some organisms some similarities but also give many organisms dissimilarities? Ken Hovind tried answering this with organisms use what they're given, but is that necessarily true? Not always, because such things as vestigial organs exist. Vestigial organs aren't necessarily non-functional, although some, like the dew claw of dogs or the wings of emus, are, but are reduced in size or differ in function from their predecessors. The appendix, for example, is descended from an organ that allowed our ancestors to digest cellulose, but now it has a minor function in the immune system. The palmaris longus muscle similarly is vestigial, being absent in both arms in about 20 million Americans and only present in one arm in about 50 million Americans. If the creationist hypothesis that a particular god is responsible for creating all the variety within life, then there must be some way to check it. One way to set up an experiment would be to take a single population of, say, monarch butterflies and separate it into two. If one population becomes darker or lighter or some other morphological change occurs, then we can safely conclude that morphological variation simply arises as a result of genetics and time. Creationists can talk about the limits of genetic variation all they want, but they have still failed to produce any experiments validating their hypothesis. So, we can repeatedly verify that structures can be modified and the genes for them can be passed through successive generations. That leads us to genetics, which is by far the best support for common ancestry. Genetics shows unequivocally that we are most closely related to chimps. That is, we share about 98.5% of our DNA. The next organism with which we share the most similar DNA is the gorilla, followed by the orangutan. Unsurprisingly, we are more closely related to all other primates than to any other organisms. Genetics links all organisms to all other organisms, and in the vast majority of cases, genetics confirms the relationship that morphology proposes. Horses and rhinos share odd numbers of toes, while giraffes, the okapi, deer, cow, buffaloes, and other hoofed mammals share an even number of toes. As it turns out, horses are most closely related to rhinos, comprising the perissodactyls, and the even-toed ungulates are all closely related to each other, comprising the artiodactyls. But whatever differences there are in morphology, the sequence of genes within an organism is the definitive answer to who is related to who. The relatedness among organisms is confirmed in exactly the same way that paternity tests are done, so we know the process works. Thus, morphology and genetics are in general concerned about the phylogeny of life, But what about the fossil record? For apes alone, there is a spectacular fossil record. There are various subspecies of Homo sapiens, like Yadaltu, Denisovans, Neanderthals, and sapiens, ourselves. Numerous species of Homo, like Naledi, Floresiensis, Antecessor, Heidelbergensis, Erectus, and Habilis. Different species of Australopithecines, Afarensis, Africanus, and Sediba. Apes that show characteristics of chimps and humans, like Ardipithecus, Ororin, and Sahelanthropus. Early African apes, like Chororopithecus and Nicalopithecus. Monkey-like apes, like Proconsul. Ape-like monkeys, like Aegyptopithecus. Basal platyrrhines, like Apidium. Basal haplorrhines, like Eosimius. Basal strepsirrhines, like Darwinius. Basal primates, like Nothoctus and Altiatlasius. And even proto-primates, like Purgatorius. We are undoubtedly linked to all other primates. There are, of course, other links out there among organisms worth mentioning. Baleen whales are linked to toothed whales by fossils like Chonocetus and the fact that baleen whales have the genes for making teeth, even though baleen whales don't make teeth. Cetaceans are also linked to artiodactyls by fossils like Indohyus, Pachycetus, Ambulocetus, Remingtonocetus, Georgocetus, and others. Snakes are linked to lizards by genetic similarities in fossils like Pachyrhachus and Tetrapodophis. Mammals are linked to reptiles by fossils like Dimetrodon, Gorgonopsians, and Cynodonts. Birds are linked to non-avian dinosaurs by Auroranus, Ancyornis, Archaeopteryx, and Chaotingia, and share numerous genetic similarities with crocodilians. The theory that birds are dinosaurs even allowed paleontologist William Beebe to make the prediction that a dinosaur with flight feathers on its arms and legs would be discovered. And in 2003, over 100 years later, Microraptor, which possessed this characteristic, was discovered, confirming Beebe's prediction. Moving on, limbless Sicilians are united with all other amphibians through genetics and fossils like Eosicilia. Lobe-finned fish are united with tetrapods through genetics and fossils like Eusthenopteron, Pandorichthys, Tiktaalik, and Acanthostega. Ray-finned fish are united with lobe-finned fish through genetics and such forms as Giyu, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Genetic and morphological similarities like a post-anal tail, endostyle, pharyngeal slits, a hollow nerve cord, and a notochord link fish and tetrapods with lancelets and tunicates. Deuterostome development unites all of us with echinoderms and hemichordates. Bilateral symmetry unites us with acoelomorph flatworms. And multicellularity, having an internal digestive tract and heterotrophy, unites us with all other animals. To summarize, common ancestry is confirmed by mountains and mountains of fossil evidence, which is independently corroborated by genetics and morphology. As famous American geneticist Francis Collins said, quote, "Yes, evolution by descent from a common ancestor is clearly true. If there was any lingering doubt about the evidence from the fossil record, the study of DNA provides the strongest possible proof of our relatedness to all other living things." End quote. On the other side of the aisle, the proponents of creationism explain all of what we see by way of magic. That's really it. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.